I'm an endodontist. I do root canals for a living. How many here have been in my office to have root canals? Just one hand. It's an interesting profession. When I was starting out, going into medicine, changing careers, my dad said, if you're going into medicine, have something to do when you retire. He said, because doctors lose their prestige in the community. And so I thought about it a while, and I said, what could be more fun than whiskey and checkers? So that's where this got started. We had a party at the house, and another one of my friends at my birthday party said, I'm making whiskey. And I said, you need to get a permit, or you'll get locked up. And he said, oh yeah, okay, well, we'll worry about that later. I said, no, let's go get a permit. So we ran and got a permit for it. We actually started out as part of Blackbeard's crew, if you're not familiar with the crew over there is where it started. So yes, there's a whole bunch of degrees up there. And this is me, all the things that I've done here. When we get down to the bottom here, it says TBD PhD in history. Well, my wife said if I go back to get one more degree, it better be law, because I'm going to need a good lawyer. She's right here. So we have a business. It's called H.Shire's Colonial Distillery. We wanted to reproduce the first spirits as they came into America. We started researching it. So the presentation I have tonight is not finished. So those of you that are seasoned historians, please be kind. Please be very kind to me tonight. When you're a historian, you're looking for primary sources is what you're looking for. You're not looking for something somebody repeated over and over and over. And there's so many things in history that somebody wrote a book on it, put a line in it, and it continues to be quoted for years and years and years and years. So we've had some trouble doing the research with some of those phenomenon happening. So our mission is to research, preserve, teach, and present the history of distillation. We started out thinking we understand it. We've expanded it to distillation we know covers so many aspects of our life. When you walk into your house, you almost can't get away from some aspect of distillation that affects your life today. We know that it covers science, spirits, we're going to talk about tonight, perfume, culinary, and the medicine roots. If you want to find us, we are H.Shire's Colonial Distillery. It's simple to find us on the web. We also have a foundation that we're starting to put our artifacts into up there, so we're collecting them in a little teeny room that we have up there. If you come up and see us, it's a little hole in the wall. I promise you it's not that impressive, but we're working on it. We're looking for somebody that's got an extra $2 million that wants to donate. If you win the lottery, none of us did, call me, please. So what do you know about distilled spirits? Anybody here like whiskey? Trick question. In the federal government, the regulations cover, TTB covers Chapter 4, these are all the names that they have for all the liquors that we have today, and each of them is defined differently. The big definition of whiskey is a distilled spirit made from grain. That's all it is. Well, to get there, you have to make something in between. Anybody know what you have to make in between before you get whiskey?
Mash.
What?
Mash.
What does mash make?
Made out of corn.
Yes, but what's it become after you ferment it? Beer. So all whiskey is, if you want a simple definition, is distilled beer. That's it. So make something out of grain, make a beer, and then distill it. There's nothing to it. So when you see people pouring a whiskey shot into their beer, it's the same thing that came out of the beer, you're pouring back into it there. So some people think they're cool, they got these tastes going on, but it's nothing very complex than that. So if I were to ask you which were the first of the commercial spirits, because when we're tracing through history, it really isn't what was made first. What was made first, you'll see in a couple of minutes, was a whole bunch of things, but then the continuity was lost. So if they made something 2,000 years before Christ was born, but nobody continued to do it, was it really the first time? So I'm trying to cover the first time we had continuity, is what I'm trying to cover in the research. When was the first person that invented it, that invention continued throughout history? So who thinks, if I ask a trick question, what do you think the first distilled spirit was? Any guesses? Speak up. Yes, sir.
Brandy.
Very, very close. So they made a couple of things. It's called Brandewine, and I can't even pronounce the Dutch pronunciation of that. Can you speak Dutch? No, I can't either. But yes, brandy was thought to be the first one. But there were some other spirits made called aquavit, eau de vie, or whiskybah, were the three names that they had for it. It's a Gaelic word. Ishkibaha is another pronunciation. It's spelled a little differently, but they're all the same word. That's exactly right. All right, a woman that kind of knows her Gaelic in America. So there's some discussion on it, whether brandy was the first one or whether it was aquavit or eau de vie, which would have been made from grain. And historically, we can't tell the difference. So we're talking about a timeline of how liquor came to be. If you want to talk about it, it started with beer and wine, then they learned to make tinctures or medicines out of it. Aquavit and brandy came along next. Now, when I list over here alembic and alembic cooling, we then think rum came along, then gin, then bourbon, arrack, and whiskeys that we have today. And some of the methods of distilling I listed over here is how it changed through time. Today, we even have vacuum distilling, where they will reduce the pressure. Freeze-dry machine, it runs a similar technology, and you can actually have it in your house, where they lower the pressure, so the temperature, PVE equals NRT, for those of you that are scientists and know how that works. You can lower the pressure and change the triple point, where you can change it from solid to liquid to gas all at the same point. It's some neat technology they're using. So distillation, but back in time, there were some stills listed, and they were all glass. These were all forms of glass stills that were used back in the 1500s and the 1600s. One of the things that we have today that we talk about are heads, hearts, and tails in the liquor. That was not a colonial way of separating. They distilled it, they drank it, and that was it. The big question was, are you gonna keep it in that barrel very long, or can we have it now? So there wasn't a lot of aging when it first started out. So for many years, there was no such thing as what we call whiskey. And I look back and I think, what sad times they had. You know, back in Shakespeare's time was about the time. So if you don't know the timeline we're talking about is in England is the same time that Shakespeare lived. The early 1600s is where we're going to kind of focus on here tonight. Some of the process of making liquor, you have to have a sugar to make liquor. Where does that start? Well, if you're using a grain, it starts with a carbohydrate. Can carbohydrates be processed into alcohol? The answer is no. Those are long chain molecules. So we have enzymes that are in grains when we malt them. So when you said malt, malt is when you take a grain and you germinate it, and it has special enzymes in it that convert the carbohydrates to sugar so the plant can live. Well, the trick that they learned was you trick it, and you take those carbohydrates, those enzymes, and turn it on for a little bit, and then you shut it down and dry it out while those enzymes are active, and all of a sudden you've got these enzymes you can put in water and digest all those carbohydrates into sugars. You can then ferment them, distill them, and process them. So the big difference between then and now is they had open tanks. They didn't have a lot of temperature control. So the colonists, when they first came to America, would generally ferment or make their beer in the spring or the fall, unless they could trick it. And they would hang a flag out on the side of the tavern and say, it's ready. And you had about a day or two, maybe three, to come drink it before it went bad. So if all of it wasn't drank, it got distilled. So now, we mostly make liquor in sealed tanks. If you've been to a distillery, for most of them, you'll see these wonderful big metal sealed tanks, except for a couple of distilleries that have learned that if you leave it open fermentation, like this one is here, and this is the style we're using at the distillery now, that it does something special. It lets bacteria in there. Well, if bacteria get into your fermentation, what does it do? Anybody know? It contaminates and it makes bad beer. All liquor is distilled beer. And it contaminates with something called carboxylic acid. So bacteria make carboxylic acids. The first thing you get is a sour beer. A couple of you like sour beers in here, I'm sure. Yeah, there's one head nodding right there and another one back there. But sour beers, if they progress, will go into vinegar. Well, vinegar not only has acetic acid in it, it has some other carboxylic acids in it too. When you walk into a bakery, what do you smell? Not the yeast, you smell the products. So you're smelling esters and aldehydes. Well, if you take that carboxylic acid and you put it in alcohol, it just makes a bad beer. But if you put it under heat, like you're distilling it, those molecules combine and you get esters. So you can create in your liquor something you don't have in the beer in dominant flavors, esters that can give liquor a much better flavor. And you get that by doing open fermentation. We have engineers out there. Y'all saw my degrees. I'm an aerospace engineer. Well, the objective as an engineer is to make the purest and the best product you can make. But to make the best whiskey, you got to make the worst beer you can make to make the best whiskey. And a lot of distillers don't know that yet. They're still back in engineering school trying to make it. So these are some of the stills. So when we started out at the distillery, and we were trying to do a historic, I had a gentleman walk in. His name was Mr. Eisenhart. And he said, my great, 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 great grandfather worked for George Washington for something called the Whiskey Rebellion, if any of you are familiar with the Whiskey Rebellion. And he said he helped make the wheels, but he was also a distiller. And I have the original patterns for the still that he made, and we think it was the first commercial still distributed in America. And I said, oh, great, it's nice to know, nice to meet you. I said, and what do you do for a living? I'm a coppersmith. And I said, great, six generations down, and they're a coppersmith, and he's got the original patterns. So we made a still, a replica of his still, and that's where we started out with that replica of that still. Then we had a lady walk in who said, I did an excavation at Carter's Grove, and we found what we think was the first still made in America. When they came over to America on the ships, what technology did they have? They really had nothing that they could do, but they knew how they could make ceramic things here in America. So if you're familiar with Jamestown and some of the ceramics that came through there, we think that there was at Carter's Grove a person who made Martin's 100, it was called then. So Martin's 100 became Carter's Grove. So she showed me a replica of a still that they brought up. It took them a while to figure out what it was. And this is where historians irk me. Historians lie. Archaeologists lie. I went through some of the references that I could find, and some of the references tried to trace it back to primary sources. And even Noel Hume, if some of you know Noel Hume, some of his books, I had to challenge him. And he was like, well, guess what I did back then. I was like, great, well, show me the reference. And he's too late, he couldn't find him then, he's gone now. Where was I? Got off on a tangent, pretty colors.
A woman walked in.
Oh yeah, a woman walked in and she had this replica picture. And so I said, let's make one. So we made a replica of the first still made in America. Well then after that, I was over at Jamestown Rediscovery, who's digging up the things, and they said, we have these pieces of glass and we're pretty sure it's a still too. And I looked at it and I said, yep, sure it is. I said, I didn't know that we had one here. He said, we found pieces of seven of them in the well, the 1608 well that we dug up. And I said, oh, I'd love to see those. So I got over there to Jamestown Rediscovery and he said, oh, and we've got this water that we dug up from the 1608 well that we don't know what to do with. Would you like it? Yeah, I'd really like to have it. So we got the well water from the 1608 well. We got the pieces from the stills that John Smith brought over on the first voyages that they had thrown in the 1607, 1608 well. We had, and I looked at the archaeologist there, and I said, you know, Corning has one of those in their historic library. He said, no, they don't, not like this. And I showed him that picture right there. And I said, yes, they do. So we called up Corning and said, can you make another one? And they said, sure, we'll be glad to. So we made a replica of the still, and you see it right here. So this is one of the ones that Corning made for us. Right here, an alembic still circa 1608. So we had the still, we had the water, we had Jamestown Bottling House, which could blow bottles, replicas of the period. We have one of those here. So this is a period bottle that we said is what's called a case bottle. And then we had to find out how to cork it, and they corked them mostly with lead back then. And we said, oh, that'd be great for our customers. A little lead in their drink. So we had to find other period methods of sealing the bottle that would meet today's standard. That was a big research project on its own, too. The only thing we needed was the grain. So we called our supplier and said, can you get us some heritage grain from England? Sure. It was there that month. We could put it all together, and we made a replica of the first liquor that was here in America. Now, the archaeologist looked at me and said, no, we don't know they made that, they used that for making liquor. I said, yes, they did. This is one of the methods that they first started out. So the copper stills they thought were poisoning people, and they were. They were doing some bad things. So what they did is they would use these glass stills from the library, and if they wanted to make a big batch, they would heat it up and stack them all up here like this to make a larger batch until they discovered that, wait a minute, it wasn't the copper that was poisoning everybody. It was the heads. Remember we talked about three parts, heads, hearts, and tails? Well, there's special things in heads, hearts, and tails. Heads is the light alcohols that come out, they're poisonous. The hearts are the part that you keep, the ethanol that you keep, the wonderful part of the middle. And the tails are, well, you can guess what it smells like. It smells like a horse's tail when it comes out. And it smells horrible, but if you do different things with it, you can come out with this blend of flavors that's absolutely wonderful if you're making a really bad beer. So we pulled this still out, we got the fermentation together, and we said, let's do, and what the archaeologist there at Jamestown said, applied archaeology. And I said, oh, this is so much fun. I'm now into history. I hated history when I was in high school. Until I heard about this battle called the Battle of Ticonderoga. So there was a big fort up in the New York, Pennsylvania area, Ticonderoga, that they went up there. Some people from right here went up there to take the fort. The story goes, and I'm still working on documenting this story, but they got to the fort, and they were always gave the men liquid courage before they went out. So they went to the local bar. The local bar is still famous for this battle. They gave the men apple cider, but they didn't have enough. So they poured rum into the drink. Made a drink called the Stone Fence, which is famous today. It's just apple cider and rum mixed together. And the men got so excited, they decided they were going to go. Let's go ahead and go tonight. They got a lot of courage going on. By the time they got there the next morning, they knocked on the door, and the commander came to the door, and he said, in his pajamas, and said, take the fort, I'm going back to bed, call me when I wake up, and we'll talk. One of the first battles of the American Revolution. Now, some of you think there were other important battles, but I think this was the most important battle of the Revolution. And there's a reason I think that. They got the cannons. And if you're familiar with the story, they had some horrible times getting those cannons down to the Boston Harbor. They got them down to the Boston Harbor, defended the Boston Harbor against the British from getting a foothold in America. Now, if they had British had gotten a foothold, I think they could have landed all their equipment, all their men, and we'd be speaking with a little different accent right now. So I think that's the most important battle because it prevented the British from that foothold. And to make that battle happen, it required rum. So I think rum is the reason we have our independence right now. Some other examples of the glass stills around the late 1500s, the early 1600s, and when they started with the copper stills. They learned that you could take the heads out, and that's why when they went back to the copper stills, they said, well, if we take the heads out, it doesn't poison people anymore. The other problem they were having was lead poisoning. So some of the lead soldering and some of the lead glasses they were using at the time was also poisoning people too. There's a lot that goes into making some good whiskey here. We're not going to cover the technicals tonight. But some of you that are seasoned historians that know things about what we call primary sources know that there's a lot of things that you have to research to find a topic sources. And so many things are intertwined with the research that you have to do. You have to look at the technology at the time. For instance, finding primary resources at the time of the period was very difficult. There's not a lot of written. They didn't think whiskey was a big thing like we think it is today. So it wasn't labeled as whiskey. Some of the terminology we had to do. There's so many influences. Major events in history changed some of the things, discoveries that they had. So here's some of the sources that I have, some quotes that I have. I'm trying to collect all that I can. And part of what I'm looking for is if you guys come across anything, please call me because I'm still looking for primary sources. Last night I was online listening to a Jin presentation about some things that we were trying to discuss with Jin, and somebody finally uncovered some of the primary sources. Just last night we're finding things. At one time we even thought Jin was one of the first liquors made in there. One of the first things we came across as difficult in this was the language. The language from then to now has changed. If you're a language major, you know that the English language is not a static language. It is a dynamic language. The same words that we use today were not used back then. So try going back to the 1500s and 1600s and try to research something. It's almost translating. The only thing that's worse is trying to read Shakespeare at times. So some of the things that were confusing to us is barreling. They also called it aging or putting up. Grain. If you don't know it, the word grain in English translates to a British word. That word is corn. So going back through the references, we would see corn. In England, in the 1500s, and we were like, where did that come from? They didn't know about corn in England. Well, the word corn in some of the references referred to grain, and it could refer to any grain. So some of the words we use in our language really don't translate from the sources that we got them in the English language. The proper name for corn is maize. So you think of that as an antique word? No, it is not. It is still the definition of the word that what we call corn. It is properly called maize. Essence was spirit, whiskey. There's some marketing things going on in the market right now about whether it has an E or not. Don't listen to it. It's just marketing. There's nothing true about the tradition, about the difference between the two words. Aquavit started out. When we're looking at the English settlers first coming over, the captain always had a barrel of aquavit, eau de vie, wishkaba. Ishkabaha, however you want to pronounce it. It all meant the same thing. It means the water of life. So if you distilled something that looked like water, but you got some essence out of it, wasn't that more of the essence of life? Because water sustains us. So they would distill this beer and get this water-like substance. It had to be something close to God, was why it was thought. So they got that name. But aquavit started out as baptismal water. So if you go back to the old Latin, it was the water they used to baptize. And it had a couple of other. But around the 1600s, 1500s, and I'll show you a reference to that in a bit, it changed its name. So there was some very much confusion in it. Where does liquor start? Well, the best reference we have is the 7000 BC. There was some pots they discovered, and I don't have the reference up here, where there is suggestion of fermentation. We don't know whether it was just something they put in a pot or whether they were actually doing it, but there were enough pots in that collection that the conclusion is that that's where fermentation started and has continued ever since. In 4000 BC, again, there were some references that they found in some archaeological digs. So alcohol has been with us for a while, not distillation. Distillation, we think, was the first reference we have, they think, is Maria the Jewess in Alexandria, somewhere in that time period. The reason we don't know is because it wasn't documented till 500 years later that somebody wrote some down. So we have a documentation 500 years later. Well, how many years is 500 years? That's a lot of years. Is that reference good? We don't know yet. This is the first person credited with it becoming, and I can't say his name, it's Arabic. I speak English. I don't do real well. It was the first alembic still made out of it. He's also, so this gentleman, Al-Razi, is credited with naming the first reference of aquavitae as first reference used, and they were using it in medicine. What we don't know is whether it was top or bottom distillation. So if you want to know more about the difference there, there's when we distill something out, we get a gas that comes up. That gas is top distillation. What's left in the pot is bottom distillation. So if you're worried, what's the difference between top and bottom? It's what's left in the pot. Well, both have uses if you're going through science. For instance, if you're distilling for perfume, the stuff you get out of the top, you'll use for perfume. The stuff you keep in the bottom, hydrosol is the proper name that we use for it today. Or is hydrosols, and it has flavors in it too. So there'll be alcohol-soluble ones that come out of the top and water-soluble molecules that will stay in the bottom. It was a neat little way to separate things. The Benedictine monks, we have some references in here as it continued through Europe into the 1300s. Then the printing press came along, and that was great because we could now start documenting some of the things that happened. Around 1493, the best reference we have to alcohol starting in America, the first reference to it coming to the Americas, is Columbus brought sugarcane over, and sugarcane originated in the Philippines, and that over in that area and migrated through Africa, and there's some documentation that covers it, but it's not distillation, so I'm not going to cover it deeply here. But when sugar came, that's the origins of rum. While we were talking about Brandywine, here's our Brandywine reference, our first Brandywine reference. And Amsterdam had a tax in 1497. So we think there was some distillation going on around then. Back in 1514, Louis. In the 1500s, the first Distillers Guild. Most of the big distillers were in the what's called the Low Countries, the Belgium, Luxembourg, Germany area. Became known for some of the major distillers. Now, this is where we're talking about Ishkabaha, as one of the pronunciations goes, was the first reference to it. It's interesting, and the reason I include it, because we think the way it's pronounced, the first part of it is ish or weesh, depending upon what dialect you're calling, and we think that word became whiskey. Except the word Ishkaba or Ishkabaha stayed on to represent another product. So in the late 1700s, we find a reference to a recipe, and we just made the recipe last week, a Ishkabaha, from a recipe that we found in the 1700s. And we thought it was going to be one of those, because at the distillery, we're not trying to make the best whiskeys for you. I don't care whether you like my whiskey or not. And most distillers don't have that attitude. What I care about is giving you a taste of history. So if you come in the distillery, I'm going to have products that we made using the colonial processes here. And I'm going to have one historic products. So we call these our colonial products because they're made using the methodology, and we have our historic products that are made using the actual equipment as best as we can get to it. So two little lines, that's a big difference in price. These are about $20 to $90. That's $1,200 to $2,000 a bottle in there too, because we can only produce so much. They only gave me 10 gallons of water from Jamestown, so I had to spread it out to put it in everything so you can get a taste of original Jamestown. The first reference we have for rum, we believe, was actually started in South America. So cachaca, I'm not saying that right again, I don't know Spanish that well, is the first reference that we have made in South America. It came around the Caribbean into America and became very popular. All the distillers in England were using, does anybody know what the grain was that was popular in England? Barley. Barley was the main grain, it was about what they used for everything. They didn't know about all the other grains or how they could use them. Corn wasn't there, it was an American. As we go through history though, we found some neat little references. Ben Franklin was trying to be a jokester. He came up with a whole bunch of names for being drunk. If you're interested in any of them, they're really cute when you read through some of them. Some documentation, the first book on distilling. One thing I'm working on now is researching the manifest, because we don't have a lot of writings from the first voyages over here. A lot of people think that Jamestown was the first voyages. It was not. The voyages started long before him, back in the late 1500s, the voyages from England. But the Spanish were here almost 100 years before us. Imagine 100 years before us, before our ancestors came over to settle the North American territory. The Spanish claimed it all, and the British said, mm-mm. Some of that's ours, you haven't claimed it and took it from them. There were some wars over there in Europe. Around 1607, it's important to me, because that's the well that we got the water from. They found seven glass stills in the waste sites, and all the ships that came over listed aquavit on their manifest. Now the interesting thing about the aquavit, guess where it was stored? The captain's quarters. He needed his medicine. Now, some of you are old enough to remember our aunts and uncles who needed their medicine, too. Some of you today still need your medicine. I see some heads nodding. It's an interesting. We're trying to find out where the first fermentation distillation occurred. And a lot of people right now are referencing Berkeley. It's pronounced Barkley in English, Berkeley in American. Plantation as being the first reference. We don't know. The reference they have there says they made a good beer. They're claiming it was the first distillation. We're kind of challenging that and trying to see, can we find the first reference there? So we have a product out called Smites that we're naming it for now. We're keeping that reference as long as until we can find a proper reference. 1614 is the ceramic still we covered from Martin's 100, that one that I said first one made in America as we run through it. By then, here in this era, the rum distillation from South America had moved in the Caribbean. And the first licensed distillery by the government was up in Staten Island. I went up there to find out, well, what were they making? Well, all they got was the license. That's it. They never made the first drop. So we're still trying to find the first licensed distillery, and nobody can make the claim. But everybody's claiming this was the first one. And I'm like, well, they didn't make anything, so what? What good does it do me? A couple of other references that we're following. Oh, here's an interesting one. King William of Orange. If y'all don't know the history of England, you know the royalty of England aren't English. Does everybody know that? They're a mix of Spanish and Dutch. King William of Orange was do I get this right? Was Protestant? Yeah, King William of Orange was Protestant. And they had a Catholic king at the time they were trying to get rid of. So when they needed the new king, there was a whole bunch of wars and things. What was it, the 80 Years' War? No, that was the Dutch. What was the war for King William? Anybody know? It doesn't matter. King William came over, took the throne from the Catholics. They wanted the Protestants in there. When he came, gin had been a very popular drink around. But he loved gin. So he passed all these laws protecting England's economy, thinking that they could make gin because he loved it, everybody else was going to love it. So he passed law after law after law after law, making England wouldn't import anything, but they could make a lot of gin and they could export it. It caused what we call the gin craze in England that continued for about 50 years after that. until they got new heavy regulations that got it. So for a penny, you could buy all the gin you could drink and a straw cot to sleep in the street, was some of the references that we have over and over and over and over again. The gin was horrible. I mean, it was a vile, nasty, nasty gin. We tried to make some reproductions of what it was back then, and it's nasty. You don't want to drink it. What they found is it was so nasty that you could fake it by using the methanol or the heads from it, which is the poison part, and adding a little bit of turpentine to it. And you could make something that almost tasted like gin, and it would poison people. So they had to pass some regulations. So the regulations came along to make a dry gin. A dry gin had to be made a certain way. There were some regulations to cover. They're way too detailed to cover here. But the dominant flavor had to be Genever. Well, Genever is juniper in our English that we speak today. So it had to have the dominant flavor and it had, of that, and it had to be pure vodka. So when you ask about vodka and gin, that's where the vodka comes from, is them trying to, the Guild of England trying to pass laws that regulated and made sure that what we now call London dry gin was made a specific way, and it was made so specific that you could taste the purity of it, and you knew you weren't gonna get poisoned. George Washington, I don't know if you know about the election with George Washington, but George Washington, for his election to House of Burgess, he lost the first one. Do you know why he lost? What's quoted as the cause? It was because he didn't serve good liquor. He ran for president. Guess what he changed? The liquor. And he served much, much more of it. And so there's some underwriting that we have that we see that talks about people won elections by the amount that they served there at the polling place, the party that they threw for the people, and how much liquor they could toss into them as to how their vote went. You know about rum becoming the official drink of the Royal Navy, the official liquor of the Navy, Red Dot Day, if you're not familiar with that. There's some British history that's not part of our... but it is how the British got... Admiral Vernon got tired of his men getting too drunk. So he said, we're going to water it down. Your rations that you get every day are going to be cut in half because we're going to cut it with water and we're going to put lime in it. That's how the British, we think today, got called the Limeys there. What are we doing here? There's where George Washington lost, and he won later by serving a better liquor. The Revolutionary War. Laird's was granted the first Applejack. This is interesting why I want to include this, because if you've ever drank a bottle of what now we call Applejack, it is not the original Applejack. Does anybody from up north know how Applejack was originally made? It was made by cold distillation. So there's two methods of distillation. There's hot distillation and cold distillation. Well, hot distillation is what you're familiar with. You watch moonshiners, they put a fire under it, it separates, the light alcohol comes up, the heavy water stays down in the tank. Cold distillation is different. You put it outside, so you make apple cider, you ferment it, you put it outside in the yard up north, and you let it freeze. Well, alcohol, as you know, doesn't freeze. That's how you make those little packs you have in your refrigerator. There's a little alcohol in them. It keeps them from freezing solid unless it's really, 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 really cold. So as it freezes, only the water freezes. Well, if you want alcohol, you want to take the water out. So in a hot distillation, you take the alcohol out. In cold distillation, you take the water out. And what's left over is alcohol. Well, don't try it, please. I tried it in my freezer. So I took some apple wine and put it in the freezer. We froze it, we pulled the water out, and the stuff you drink is just nasty. I mean, it keeps all the nasty flavors that you would ever want. So you may think that, oh, I can make this myself in my freezer. Please don't. It's some nasty, nasty stuff. So what we're trying to do is reproduce the first ones. So we thought about how can we reproduce the first Applejack, and we really haven't gotten to a point where we can say we can make the first Applejack the way it was made back then. We don't know how to do it. If you have some ideas, tackle me after this and give me some ideas. One of the ideas we had was to do the first distillation to kind of get some of those bad stuff out, then take that product and then freeze it to kind of get a drinkable reproduction. But then we wouldn't be authentic. So we're not sure how to go about this. You've heard about Mount Vernon, about George Washington making some liquor. George Washington made some rye whiskey is what he made. Mr. Anderson, who worked for him, said, we can make some money, we can make liquor. They made rye whiskey for 3 years. George Washington died during that period, so that's why the whole distillery fell apart. If you ever get to go see a distillery besides ours, go see that one. It is a marvelous, marvelous feat of technology for the time. They had the grain mill that was there, and that's where I was fascinated all day long, learning how they fit all those parts together and get them to work. It's a wonderful place to go visit. It's not at Mount Vernon, it's part of the old Mount Vernon plantation, so it sits somewhere else, so they could dump the grains and the waste all in the river and pollute the rivers and all the stuff they did in the colonial times that we don't try to do today. They distill twice a year up there. They make some wonderful, they're learning how to make some wonderful rye. If you've had rye, you know it's not the best liquor in the world, but it can be drunk, so if you get up there, try the 2-year barreled stuff. It's a couple $100 for a bottle that size of that small green one right there. And if you're worried about tasting, just get one bottle and share it among friends. That's how you do. Somebody asked me, what's the best bourbon in the world? Any volunteers here? What's the best bourbon? Anybody know? Right now, Pappy's is going for about $5,000 a bottle. So some people out there that think Pappy's is the best bourbon in the world. Why would you pay $5,000 for a bottle? You got an extra $5,000? Loan me some. The best bourbon is the one you like. We have tastings at the distillery, we bring people in, and one of the tastings that we do is we put each of the different grains of whiskey out there, the bourbons that are made. So some bourbons are all corn, some bourbons are corn and wheat, some bourbons are corn and rye, some are corn and other things. And we acclimate your taste buds. We educate you, here's a bourbon made this way. Because I get so many women that come in there and say, I don't like bourbon. And I'm like, well, you haven't really drank any if you don't like it, because there's 1,000 different flavors in bourbon, depending upon who made it or what grains they made it with. And we can sit you down and show you, which one do you like? Do you like the rye taste? Do you like the wheat taste? Do you like the corn taste? Which blend appeals to your taste buds? So we try to get you to the point where you can recognize what's the best bourbon, the one you like. Well, can you figure out which one you like? There's some interesting things that took place in the history here in America. But barreling here's the hard part that we had to research. We were trying to find out, when did barreling become a standard? Well, back in the colonial times, what did they have to store it in? Barrels, that was it. So they had dry barrels and wet barrels. They would put things in the wet barrels and store it. Well, it didn't last long if it was liquor. It was roll it out, roll it to the tavern, and sell it now. It didn't last long. They didn't know that barreling had a distinct flavor to it. So we start to find some references to it. So it wasn't until the 1820s that we find an advertisement, a letter referencing the first word bourbon for it. There's some debate if you want to go around and say, where was bourbon invented? Well, if you're in Kentucky, what do they tell you? It was invented in Kentucky, and it was named bourbon in the county of Bourbon. There's some debate there because they were shipping it down the Mississippi to Bourbon Street, Louisiana. So the Louisianans claim, wait a minute, that's where the name came from. We don't know which is right yet. We're still looking for documentation. If you come across some, this is a big one that we're looking for in the archives, is how far can we go back to trace bourbon? But by definition, when did bourbon get its formal name? Does anybody know? When was bourbon actually first defined? Huh? No, that was the definition of whiskey, not bourbon. Bourbon wasn't defined as an American drink with that name until 1964. It wasn't fully defined and said, this is what it is, it has to be made in America. I'm gonna ask you that question in just a minute, how much do you know? There it is, 1964, it went by. So some of the liquors that we're talking about here, I just threw this slide together last night. Brandy, possibly the first commercial spirit as we were talking about. Possibly the first aquavit, but also so was single malt. So if you come into our place, we're trying to make a reproduction of aquavit, eau de vie, right here with this bottle that we got from the Jamestown. So the name transferred to a couple of different products, and there's some debate as to whether brandy was what was called aquavit or single malt was what was called aquavit. Rum, we know, started in South America, then to Barbados, then to America, and gin, first popularized in the Netherlands, popularized when he came to England, William of Orange came to England. And bourbon, we're still having a debate on that one. Was it 1620s, when was it first made? It wasn't named that then, but we think that's when the first ones were made with the first settlers that came here, because they found maize, they knew they could ferment it, they knew they could make a beer, and they had stills. We don't have documentation that says they used the stills. This is where some of the debate comes up. If you're a historian, you know we want this reference, that primary reference that actually says they used it. Well, if it was made, the modern definition of bourbon is right here. Bourbon must be made in America. It must be at least 51% corn or minimum. It can be distilled no higher than 159. This is the 1964 requirements. Barreled no higher than 125, and then bottled at 80 proof. So if you're going to make bourbon, this is what the 1964 Act by the American government did. Well, the American government also did something, I don't remember the year of it, protectionism. You wonder about things. Why do they do things like that? Well, if you don't know, there's only two cooperages in Scotland. When we went over there, we got to visit one of them, and I was looking at the cooperage going, they're not making barrels. They're just reassembling them. Where did they get it from? And I learned that the barrels in Scotland they put scotch in are actually American bourbon barrels. They don't use new scotch bottles, scotch barrels over there. They don't even make them. They take all the old ones from here. Why is that? Why would they do that? They didn't make bourbon back then. Why would they make what we call scotch out of bourbon barrels? The history continuity there doesn't match up. Well, they didn't use bourbon barrels until the American government said, we need to protect the American coopers. So all American whiskey must be the first time use of a charred oak barrel. It was protectionism. We want to protect our coopers in America. What did that do to the European coopers? Basically wiped them out. So all the European coopers basically went out of business because our government tried to protect American business. Interesting little law they passed. We also have a spirits museum. In it, we're trying to cover those five things that we talked about, spirits, medicine, science, perfume, and the culinary uses up there too. In our little museum, and it's a little museum, it's not much bigger than the podium here. If you come up and see us, we also are a hole in the wall, so if you're expecting a big fancy place, please don't. It is literally a hole in the wall. Some of the things we're collecting in that museum are the 1608 replica, the 1608 still, and we actually use this still to make this. If I was going to make actual reproductions, I wanted the actual stuff they used. So this is the stuff, the one that I found they used to make it. I know they made it in Europe, and what they did is they barreled it and brought it here on the ships. So the first, what we call aquavit, or single malt now, as it's called, was actually brought over by the first ships that came from England. Made in these stills. When they got here, they would water it down. So that's what we did. We made it, and then we took that water that we got from the Jamestown well, and we, what we call, proofed it, or diluted it down. So we brought it from 125 proof down to 83 proof using that water from the Jamestown well. What we're going to do in the future is we have a scientific profile of that water, or what were the mineral contents of it that we got from Jamestown rediscovery, and we're going to reproduce that water that they used from the well chemically to say this, we're using the same water. We'll do that in the future. So these are the five things that we cover. And medicine was the first distillates were actually used to make medicine before they were drank as spirits. We're trying to research science, perfume, like I said, distillates and anhydrous salts. And culinary, a lot of the things that you use, any of you use vanilla? Where do you think it comes from? So we distill alcohol, we take the vanilla bark, we soak it down in a bottle, and if you want your own vanilla, that's all you have to do is get the little vanilla sticks, put it in vodka or some, make sure it's at least 80 proof, and you can make your own vanilla flavoring for your cooking out of it. We're separating the Spirits Museum from the Eight Shires, because the Eight Shires is where we're doing applications, so we're trying to set up the museum to, here's the pieces and here's how it was done. And then we're using Eight Shires as our business to actually make these spirits so you can come up and get a taste of history. Some of the spirits that we're making, so this is colonial, right here. We're making, let me tell you a story first. So how did we get our name, the Eight Shires? Does anybody know what the Eight Shires, where it came from? Do I see any hands?
First counties in Virginia,
that's almost exactly right. So the settlers, the story as we have it, when they came over, the London, Virginia Company went bankrupt. And so they had to divide it into something, and they had the House of Burgess ruling over it, and the House of Burgess said, we can't do this, it's too much. As the people spread further and further and further, they needed some local rule, and there was no way to do it. The military basically had all the rule, the military and the House of Burgess, that was it. And they were really tired of it. So the king was the King George at the time, said, go ahead and set something up. You're the House of Burgess, go ahead and do it. And divided the London, Virginia territory into eight shires. Norfolk was part of Elizabeth City Shire, in case you didn't know. I don't have the reference up here. But yes, Norfolk was part of that. So these were the eight shires right here. And what we're doing is we're trying to reproduce the first liquors, naming them after the shires, so that we can also educate people. So how long did the eight shires government last? Anybody know? Before they became counties? Go ahead. 2 years. It only lasted 2 years. That's why they don't teach it to you in school. If you're a teacher, I think I had a teacher here in the audience somewhere. Such a short piece of history is not worth even telling you about. So there's the Ishgava. You can see the spelling of it there under the Elizabeth City Shire. So we named each one of them after what we thought might have been drank or made or imported into each of those sections of the country. Molasses was the other one. So when we were making the bourbon and the rum, we said, what are the ingredients? So it's a research for applied archaeology. What are the ingredients they went into? How did they get them? So I got the first batch of corn, and you can see the video that we have on our website. You'll see that I looked at the corn and I immediately realized there's GMO in there. They didn't have GMO back in the colonial period. So I had to say, let's go back and raise colonial style corn. Well, everybody said, you can't make beer out of colonial style corn. The shells are too hard. There's no carbohydrates in it. It's where we've genetically engineered corn to where it's much more efficient today. I said, yeah, but I'm trying to get people a taste of history. I want them to taste it. So the corn we have now is raised by a farmer just north of here, who raises it. Well, Mount Vernon found out what we were doing, and guess what they did? They went over to the farmer and said, can you raise us some too? So now Mount Vernon and us are both using maize, a historical maize, to make our products from. I got the molasses in, Have you ever been to Cracker Barrel and used the molasses? That's some nasty stuff. Nasty, nasty stuff. And I started researching that, and I realized American technology today, when we get sugarcane in, we can separate it out a lot of sugar. Well, they couldn't do that back in the old times. We found a reference that said that they would separate it, heat it up, cook it, and throw away the bottom half. So we called up our supplier again and we said, can you get us some half molasses? And we are now trying to make our, and we only found one supplier that's down in South America where they're actually making, so we have to import sugarcane molasses from South America to make all of our rum products there. The way we're making it is trying to be historic as we can. The tavern rum is one that starts out, that is the one that is Silverland molasses from the bottom half. From that rum, we barrel age it. So in the time they were transporting it, if they needed to transport something, it would be the second or third use of that barrel. So that's what we did. We said, well, after we do bourbon in it, let's throw the rum in there to be the second use, because the first use of the barrel has to be whiskey. Bourbon is a whiskey. So first use of the barrel for bourbon, second use of the barrel for rum to make the gold rum that's up there. The third one was a spiced rum. So let's make a spiced rum. Do they have spiced rum back in the colonial period? The answer is no. That is a modern product that has become popular recently. What we did find out is they would have ground the spices up and put it in whatever they were drinking at the time and throw it in there to spice it up, because some of the rum they made back then was hot and it was nasty. There's a couple of references, if you didn't see them, go by for the historical references, that talked about how nasty the rum was back then. So they would grind up the spices, throw it in their drink, stir it around, throw something else in there to get it. What else do we need to know? Oh, the gin, the Genever gin. Was originally called Genever gin, now it's called Dutch gin. The reason it's called Dutch gin is because it's made from whiskey. And that was the Genever gin we were talking about earlier that could be bastardized. What was the base they made the alcohol from? Well, the only grain they had in Europe at the time they could really make something from was malt, malted barley. So all the gin in Europe at the time was made from malted barley. Well, malted barley beer is the basis for whiskey or single malt. So all the gin was made from single malt. So that's what we did. We got the single malt out. So all the gin that we have is a historic gin, is the grandfather of today's gin. It's the one that King William of Orange brought over and made popular from the Netherlands. It's a Dutch gin, Genever gin. One of the popular gins today is Bowles. If you've ever had Bowles gin, it's nasty. It's nasty. So we decided to make it, and ours turned out pretty good. There's people that come in and say, "You're kidding me, this is a Dutch gin? This is really good." So we're very pleased with the results that we got from it. This is us. You can come up and visit us. If you're interested in seeing some of the products, I've had some brochures on the table out here in back. There's my business cards too. You can get a hold of me, and that's about it.